Hello and welcome to Beyond the Black and White Binary. Thank you for joining us. My name is Dan Hurd. I'm the Director of Adult Programs at Writers and Books. I'm a white man with short blonde hair, beard, glasses, wearing a red plaid shirt. Writers and Books would like to call attention to the complex and troubled history of the lands on which we live and work. We are recording this panel from the unceded ancestral homelands of the Onondaga, or the people of the Great Hill. In English, they are known as the Seneca people, or the keeper of the Western door. As I said, this is black, beyond the black and white binary. Four writers of color discuss ways of resisting and challenging the black and white binary that often dominates conversations and frames how American culture and the publishing industry imagine race. Panelists explore how to forge and foster collaborations between black and brown writers through solidarity and a politics of community building with a focus on both craft and content. Our panelists are Valerie Boyd, Sejal Shah, and Anjali Enjeti. Our moderator is Steve Majors. With that, I'll turn it over to Steve.
Thank you, Dan. And I'd like to begin by thanking Writers and Books and let everyone know that this panel is underwritten by the Disability Visibility Project. And again, my name is Steve Majors. My pronouns are he, him, and his. I'm a biracial man. And I'm so pleased today to really be talking with some great authors here, all writers of color, we all are. And I think as Dan really talked about, we really want to delve in deep into how we can talk about going beyond the black and white binary, both in terms of our writing, also in terms of our craft. We'll be getting into questions of how we, again, can foster cross-cultural and cross-racial collaborations. So I'd like to begin by welcoming and introducing formally all of our participants. Valerie Boyd is the author of Wrapped in Rainbows, The Life of Zora Neale Hurston, winner of the Southern Book Award and the American Library Association's Notable Book Award. Formerly the arts editor at the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, Valerie has written articles, essays, and reviews for such publications as the Washington Post, Los Angeles Times, Creative Nonfiction, Oxford American, Ms. in Essence. Valerie is a professor of journalism and the Charlene Hunter Galt Distinguished Writer in Residence at the Grady College of Journalism and Mass Communication at the University of Georgia, where she founded and directs the Low Residency MFA program in Narrative Nonfiction. Anjali Enjeti is a former attorney, organizer, and award-winning journalist based near Atlanta. She's the author of the critically acclaimed Southbound, Essays on Identity, Inheritance, and Social Change, published by the University of Georgia Press in 2021, and The Parted Earth, also published in 2021 by Hub City. Anjali's writing has appeared in Oxford American, The Bitter Southerner, Poets and Writers, Harper's Bazaar, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, Publishers Weekly, and elsewhere. A former member of the National Book Critics Circle, she teaches in the MFA program at Reinhardt University. And Sejal Shah writes across genres and disciplines. She's the author of the award-winning debut essay collection, This is One Way to Dance, also out by the University of Georgia Press in 2020. Her stories and essays have appeared in The Guardian, Brevity, Conjunctions, Guernica, Kenyon Review, Literary Hub, Long Reads, and The Rumpus. The recipient of a 2018 New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship in Fiction, Sejal recently completed a story collection. Her newer writing is about mental health. You can find her online at sejal-shah.com. and on Twitter and Instagram at Sejal Shah Writes. So I'd like to begin with you, Anjali. We're gonna be asking each of our participants to read a 3-minute excerpt and we'll get into questions and we'll save time at the end for some Q&A. I'd like to turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Steve. And for our audience, again, my name is Anjali. I am a brown-skinned mixed race woman with dark hair that goes past my shoulders, and I'm wearing glasses and brown curls and a brown shirt. I'm going to read a brief excerpt for you all today from my book, Southbound, the collection of essays. And it's an essay that just so happens to tie in really well to the wonderful topic. It's called On the Unbearable Whiteness of Southern Literature. I'm going to read the very end of the essay. There is an enormous range and depth of Black Southern authors, and it is these authors who deliver, time and again, authentic, riveting stories about the Deep South. when I read Alice Walker's The Color Purple, I recognize something in that book I couldn't articulate as an eighth grader. That unlike white authored novels I'd read, this novel didn't exist to teach or show or prove anything to me. The same can be said for my first time reading Zora Neale Hurston's Their Eyes Were Watching God. Janie's fierce independence and her unwillingness to conform to societal norms went against every stereotype I held about women in the Deep South. And after I first discovered Maya Angelou's I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, I fell in love all over again with language. I carried that book around in my backpack for months. What I didn't realize in childhood that I can see more clearly today is how Southern literature has always been a genre of exclusion. Identity determines an author's Southernness more than the setting itself. According to the 2010 census, 55% of Black people live in the Southeastern United States. Yet there are not nearly as many Black Southern authors as there should be. And white Southern authors all too often pen Southern stories that belong to Black people. The Deep South first belonged to Indigenous people, yet too few Southern Indigenous books have been published. It's important that people in the South realize that they are living on Native land, said Choctaw Nation author Leanne Howe in an interview. By ignoring or not knowing or never having thought of Indians before, you've really cut yourself out of hundreds and hundreds of years of experiences of the people that came before. I can only imagine the number of Black and Native writers querying agents and editors with their Southern stories, or for that matter, the number of Cuban American writers in Mississippi, or Cambodian writers in Louisiana, or Venezuelan American writers in Tennessee, or Iranian American writers in Texas. The South has always been far more racially diverse than Southern literature has reflected. For years, I pitched a novel about an Indian immigrant family who ran a gas station in a small North Georgia town. The family's lives were tangled in secrets dating back to a tragic accident a decade earlier. The book was about the bitterness that comes from unfulfilled dreams, the isolation one can feel when living far away from a major urban center, and the toxic small town gossip that can shape a family's narrative. The novel was as a Southern novel can get. I submitted the book for many years. Several agents said they weren't sure how to sell it or didn't know who the intended audience was. I had grown up surrounded by Southern books. This was an authentic Southern story. I myself was Southern. Why couldn't they sell it as such? A few years later, a white Southern author published a novel that featured white characters and woven elements of Hindu mythology. The book embodied the perfect formula for the white gaze, Southern sensibility, and a dash of Indian garnish to deem it both marketable to white readers and exotic. Here I was, an Indian Southerner trying to sell a Southern story about Indian Southerners at a time when no other Indian Southern author was publishing novels about the South, and a white Southern author beat me to it. In 2019, my reckoning took the form of another novel by another Indian American author from the South. Davy S. Luskar's poetic debut, The Atlas of Reds and Blues. Though she now makes her home on the West Coast, Luskar grew up in North Carolina and spent several years in Georgia working and raising her children. Atlas is a reminder that there are many stories about the South that have yet to be told, and that the South is far more racially and ethnically diverse than the publishing industry has ever perceived it. It is a region rich in history, in people, and in the stories Indigenous, Black, and other writers of color are feverishly writing every day, waiting, hoping that they will someday see the light. Thank you.
Anjali, that was beautiful. Valerie, could we hear something from one of your recent work next?
Sure, thank you, Steve. And I'm really happy to be here with everyone. I'm an African-American woman. I'm peanut butter colored, and I have on a black top with a kind of black, red over sweater. and I have earrings and I have long dark hair in dreadlocks. So I'm happy to be here with Sejal, Anjali, and you, Steve. And I want to read a little bit from my new book. I have been working for the past 6 years researching and curating and editing the journals of Alice Walker. Alice Walker started keeping journals when she was 18. She turned 78 next month. And so the book that we are publishing in April is called Gathering Blossoms Under Fire, The Journals of Alice Walker. And it features more than 5 decades of her journal entries. And the excerpt I want to read, I think, really speaks to community. Black and brown writers trying to find community with each other and how that is, just an age old endeavor and adventure. And you see that in this entry that she wrote. The entry is dated November 7th, 1987. Angela, meaning Angela Davis, Angela and Toni Morrison came to dinner Monday night. Toni's hair is quite gray and very beautiful and soft. When they were leaving and we were discussing hair, I touched it. Angela, feel Toni's hair, how soft it is. And the evening was like that. I'd made soup and vegetables, and there was bread and butter and fruit and wine. Toni talked about the critics of her book. Actually, she talked about our critics, since some of those who don't like her work don't like mine. Apparently, there's a horrible review in the New Republic and reprinted in the Village Voice by Stanley Crouch. Someone handed it to her just before she went on a television or radio show. She says she's called Aunt Medea and that there's a funny, weird caricature of her. She talked about being able to erect barriers, psychological ones, to protect herself. She feels she has a power to protect herself from crazy people and from dogs. She says she mentally choked a dog someone was holding and it shat in their hands. I think Toni does have a brilliant dark power, that she is more comfortable studying evil than I. I can study confusion, which most times only looks like evil. And I have a hard time even mentally choking a dog. She was also very kind in her remarks about Ishmael Reed, saying she could never take him seriously. She seems to have known him for a long time and recently had dinner with him. She explained that when Ishmael was a little boy around 5, his mother took him to meet his father, a successful businessman who threw them out of his office. This was Ishmael's first meeting with his father. I said, this story explains his hatred of Black women writers. We keep taking him to meet his father. We talked of whether her novel Tar Baby would be made into a movie. She thought not, but later when Quincy Jones called about Warner's decision to offer me my 3% for The Color Purple, he said plans for it were indeed moving along. Uzan Palsy's husband is to direct, not Uzan. This is not good news. He said Toni would be hearing soon. Anyway, he also commented on the fact that Toni and I were having dinner together. Anyone would expect you to be enemies, he said. But why would anyone expect that? Even when I felt bad about something Toni allegedly said or did against me, I've always also felt that if I did my work, things would be okay. I explained my absence at her big city arts and lecture reading, that I was in Boston during a welfare women's benefit, and I congratulated her on the success of Beloved. I said I had it, but hadn't read it yet because I was working on something and knew when I did read it, it would blow me away. She has been offered a substantial position at Princeton. I feel glad for her success. It isn't my kind of success. There doesn't seem much laying up for days with her lover in it, but perhaps there is. I hope so. I know I couldn't stand Princeton for a day. Thank you.
Valerie, thank you. Sejal, we'd love to hear something from your work.
Thank you, Steve. That was a beautiful reading, Valerie. I can't wait to, wow, yeah, Anjali and I. I'm going to read the opening. I guess I'll describe myself. I am about the color of coffee and two creams, or cream and a half. I am wearing gold looking cardamom pod earrings and a red scarf, shawl thing. And I have green glasses. That's about all I have to say. Oh, my hair's back. It's almost always back. This is called Prelude. Sejal, I am trying to describe what it feels like. There is nothing but space in these words. When language fractures in your attempt to speak, when you are trying to talk back. Here is my booth at the carnival. What will stay and what will go? Indian, American, and girl. The body, bones, raced, erased. Stories are an argument between some words. Sejal. Weddings are a circle of stories, our bodies, streets, intersections. This is the body dancing. I am a triple threat. My mother speaks to me in Gujarati, my father in the other room reading. These two words were once linked by a hyphen. But that is not the answer. I answer her, usually in English. The space blooming now, breaking now. There is no answer, there is only a door. Is widening now. I too call myself I. Sejal. Words are surfacing, one way to dance. So that's kind of my prologue in This Is One Way to Dance. And I'll be talking about Prelude a little later today, but I want to, we haven't introduced Steve Majors, who's the author of Hyella, a modern family memoir. And Steve is a former television news journalist who worked for media organizations such as NBC News and most recently for mission-driven national nonprofits, most recently Teach for America. His essays on race, culture, and identity have been published in the New York Times, Washington Post, and other outlets. He lives in suburban Maryland with his family, and I'm proud to say he's originally from Western New York, where Writers and Books and I both are.
Thank you, Sejal. And again, I'd like to thank you for inviting me to read an excerpt of Hyella. And when we talk about sort of beyond the black and white binary, I should have described myself. I am a 50-ish year old man with light skin, although I identify as biracial and black. And that's sort of the basis of my family story, the fact that I was a white passing son growing up in an all black family. So I'll read a short excerpt. The kids on the school playground weren't the only ones who questioned where my light bright complexion came from. So did my first friend in life, my cousin Kathleen. Only 6 months in age and a few yards of crabgrass separated me and Aunt Bonnie's daughter. So from the time we were toddlers, we were inseparable. The grown-ups said, where you saw one of us, you saw the other, and they took to calling us salt and pepper. They thought it was funny, and so did Kathleen and I, till it occurred to both of us one day that our nickname didn't just mean we naturally went together. We'd already started comparing ourselves, our height, our speed, what made me a boy and her a girl. Now we began to place our hands and arms side by side to see the difference everyone else saw. Maybe you just need a suntan, Kathleen offered as she poked at my freckled skin. Yeah, maybe, I said, but neither of us was really convinced. Although I was looking for an explanation, there was another part of me that was afraid someone would tell me that I might not really belong. My raucous and raw-talking family confused and scared me, but they were all I had in the world, and as a little boy, I still needed assurance that I had a place among them. I learned the hard way not to ask them questions. The exception, though, was Kathleen. Together, we'd come to understand that we lived in an extended family where bad things happen and where everyone kept those things secret. It was comforting to know Kathleen and I at least had each other to share our own secrets and sorrows. That happened one day while we were playing our favorite game of pretend outside. Kathleen demanded she have the last word. "Shut up," she said, putting her hands on her hips like the grown folks did. Although we were the same age, Kathleen stood about an inch taller than me, and I was determined not to be bossed around. "Make me," I said. Kathleen shoved me hard until I fell on the ground. When she saw me trying to stand up, she shoved me back down and spit on me. "How do you like that, huh? Now go on and cry with your dumb self. You think I care? Run home to your mother with your stupid, funky, white ass." Her words hurt more than any physical blows could, because in that moment, Kathleen had uttered a secret curse. She didn't take delight in being a part of Salt and Pepper. Instead, she called me something that no one else had, a word she knew would hurt and confuse me. She called me white. Well, I'd love to move into the questions here. And I'm listening to all of you speak, all of you read some excerpts. And I'm really taken about how in each of those books, we really are getting at sort of the crux of this issue. And, you know, so often we discuss about how to break through that black and white binary in our writing and in our interpretation of others' writings. And we do so by discussing, and sometimes we talk about cross-cultural influence and collaborations, but so often we do it in terms of the performing and visual arts. You know, Sejal, you specifically have said in the past that you've sought inspiration from outside literature to think about your own work through a cross-cultural lens. And I'd like to show a brief clip of one such example, and we'll give a description of it on the other side, just a moment.
Steve, can I set it up a little bit?
Yes, please do.
Actually, why don't we show the clip and then I'll talk about it. So this is, it's a clip of Garth Fagan Dance. Garth Fagan is a American choreographer of Jamaican descent who is based in the Rochester area. And I grew up seeing the company perform, and I did not grow up traveling much. As a child, I had not been to Kenya, where my mother is from, nor India, where my father is from. And so this was kind of, it was a formative influence on me, I think, seeing this. And this is a clip of Prelude. So what I read, my prelude, my prologue is an homage to their prelude, which is maybe 12 minutes, something like that. But this is just a 2-minute clip that they authorized me to show. Thank you. Thanks, Steve. I love that piece so much. And this is a booklet that I worked on, a book from their 25th anniversary season. I interviewed the dancers. I was so just interested in what Fagan was doing, and they just celebrated their 50th anniversary. So what I thought would be helpful, I just wanted to read from when Anjali interviewed me for Literary Hub about my story collection. This is from that. But this is One Way to Dance is a series of gestures and movements and sound. I moved a lot in some of the years I was writing about, and then I also often wrote about the past. So movement in time, movement in space. And I knew that having studied dance for many years, and especially having studied modern dance with Garth Fagan Dance, was part of my aesthetic and artistic heritage. And what I love about that piece, we don't have the whole thing there, but you can see, well, one, code switching. I didn't have a word, I didn't know that term as a child, but I was like, okay, this is not, you know, these folks can do ballet, they can do Afro-Caribbean dance, they can do anything, but just seeing that code switching without it being explained. And also just like, I think the way the first poem in a book of poems, or maybe the first essay in a book of essays, is teaching the reader, like, this is where we're going. And there are elements of Fagan technique and his regular dance class that I used to take as a community member that were within the dance. And so I love that. And then his technique draws from ballet, modern, and Afro-Caribbean dance. He's associated with the Black Arts Movement of the mid-60s and 70s, which I didn't even know till I was in graduate school at UMass and heard about this. I didn't know that growing up. But I saw in his choreography an example of how to foreground your cultural influences without translating them. And he forged his own dance language and technique. And that's that really had an influence on me. And his company members were mostly people of color, often, but not only Black. And in segregated Western New York, it was really important for me to see people of color on stage, for me to be in a class that was mostly Brown and Black. And to be recognized as a person of color. And being part of that community widened my world and my sense of identity as a person of color, not only as someone who's Indian or Asian American, but also BIPOC. I'll stop there. And
that's fascinating. And Anjali and Valerie, I'm curious, where do you get your influences? And where do you sort of seek those sort of inspirations that may come from outside of your given community?
I'll answer if that's okay, Val. I think, Steve, it's shifted over time. When I was young, I mean, this is probably similar to Sejal's experience, but when I was growing up, even when I was in my 20s, I was predominantly in very white spaces. So at first I really, you know, I would sort of see a Brown or a Black person and, you know, kind of form a relationship with them, but there just were so few people that I was just saturated in whiteness. So it took me a little while to find my footing and to first recognize that I needed to put myself in the right community spaces. I needed to make decisions to live and to work and to build a life where I was with predominantly Black, Indigenous, and other people of color. It just was not working for me in those white spaces. And so we made a move. My family and I made a move 14 years ago, and we wound up in a city that was with the last sentence we know now is a majority minority city. But even before then, it was a very racially, ethnically, religiously diverse community. with a very large immigrant population, something like one third of it is immigrant. And then I started getting into Asian American organizing. So I just sort of made some conscious decisions about putting myself in the right place so that I could be myself. And of course, when you were an organizer for a specific community, you really are organizing with all brown and black people. I mean, it doesn't work, right? If you're solely organizing Asian Americans, you really have to rely on the black community and the Latinx community and the Arab community. And you really do have to sort of diversify the network in order to gain progress in any kind of movement. But I had to sort of look for these places and these spaces because I was in so much of a white community, and I didn't know for a while that there were any other things, that there were any other options, just simply because where my family happened to settle, it was a small southern city, and where we ended up building a life, this is the way it was. So it was quite a long, I mean, I'm 48 years old now. And I was, you know, a little more than halfway into my life before I realized that to live a life that was sustainable, to live a life that was really rich and compelling and exciting and supportive of me, I needed to change up my entire environment. And I was very, very lucky that I was able to do so.
I'd love to narrow in a little bit. And oh, Valerie, I didn't want to cut you off.
Well, I'll just say that I grew up in Atlanta, in old school Black Atlanta. If you all have seen the show Atlanta, and you know, you're familiar with the character Paperboy. Paperboy was my next door neighbor. I grew up in that part of Atlanta, old West Side Atlanta, where the J.R. Crickets is with the magical sauce and all of that. And it was after white flight. So my Atlanta public school experience was mostly Black. 99% Black students, 99% Black teachers. I had excellent Black women teachers throughout my elementary and high school education. And I was also just that kid who was interested in the arts of all kinds. And I was very different from my family, but I was the kid who would be like, hey gang, we're gonna watch For Colored Girls on PBS tonight. And my parents would be like, okay, what's that? And I would just turn to Channel 8 and watch it, and they would kind of get into it. And, you know, they let me have those explorations. And fortunately, my mom was a big magazine reader. So she was a charter subscriber to Ms. Magazine and a charter subscriber to Essence Magazine, both of which started in the 70s. And I was, you know, 10 years old reading those magazines and being formed as a thinker and as a feminist and as a writer and as an artist and an appreciator of Black print culture and as an archivist. And so that's kind of my background. And so I've always had this broad appreciation for the arts. And when during my journalism career, I sort of ended my formal journalism career as arts editor at the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. So that was fitting for the kind of impact that the arts had on me as a young person. And especially a person whose parents were not college graduates. I was first generation college, but my parents were open to my interest in the arts and supportive in their way. And so the arts have always sustained me.
That is fascinating. Well, I'd love to drill, we talked sort of about that wider community of influence, and I'd like to drill in a little bit deeper on sort of our writing communities. And I know, you know, Valerie, you and Sejal, last summer you had a conversation that was published in Creative Nonfiction. And the conversation was about common texts and literary lineages. And so, you know, what was interesting about it, I think, is that, I think what I took away from it is that you both said that the writers who have gone before us and inspired us are actually part of our community. Whether they are with us or present, they are that community that influences. Can you say a little bit more about that, Valerie?
Yeah, and I know you might want to read a little bit from that interview, Sejal, but yeah, I really feel like we get to choose our literary kin. We get to choose our mentors and our influences. And so when I think about being very different from my family, for instance, being that kid who was, you know, into the arts when my parents and my brothers weren't, but finding support for that. You know, I think about, I imagine myself the love child of Toni Morrison and James Baldwin, you know, and they become sort of literary parents for me. For me, someone like Alice Walker is my favorite auntie. And someone like Zora Neale Hurston becomes my literary grandmother. And so we get to choose our lineage, and our lineage sometimes chooses us through the books that we're drawn to, through the kinds of work that inspires us and shapes us. But I think it's perfectly, not just okay, but necessary for us to consciously make those choices and to claim our own literary ancestry.
Sejal, again, you were part of this conversation. I mean, can you share a little bit about sort of your journey to finding your community and ensuring that it's sort of robust and diverse?
Sure, thanks, Steve. Well, in that conversation, Valerie and I talked about Sula. I have all my props here. I don't want there to be glare on this, okay. Finding common texts. And I think for me, bell hooks was so important. Talking back, and I realize, of course, I have that phrase in the beginning of my book, how much she's been a guide for me, I think. We didn't mention this, and I thought I would read a little bit from the interview, but I also, one of the dancers in Garth Fagan Dance also gave me the Mississippi Masala CD a long time ago that I still have. And I was just thinking about that as just like, we're talking about not just literature, but dance. I remember being in the theater in college, I mean, seeing that movie and thinking, wait, there's no white protagonist. What? And just like, you can do this. And then I remember just more recently reading about Mississippi Masala, and Mira Nair saying that, you know, the producers tried to wanted her to cast the leads as white, but does not even make sense with the story. But there was like, you know, but who's going to go watch it if you don't have, I mean, there's Denzel, but just the fact that you had a black and brown people talking to each other about what's going on with them, their characters, their communities, and white people were on the side. And it was tremendous. That was a tremendous moment for me. And that was 1992. And I never would have thought that so much time would go, that would still seem, I assumed that things would change more.
Yeah, but I want to just jump in, Sejal, and say that movie, I'm glad you brought that up, because it was one of the first examples of showing black and brown communities, not just in proximity to each other, but loving each other.
Yes.
Friendship across black and brown lines, love across those so-called lines. And so it was a hugely important movie, and Mira Nair does amazing work. And those continue to be topics that she explores, but the impact of that kind of movie, just showing the kind of friendship and love across those communities, was extraordinarily important.
Absolutely. I mean, I don't know, Anjali, I don't know how you feel about it, or Steve, if you've seen it, but like, I remember also feeling embarrassed, frustrated at the prejudice and the colorism I saw there. But also I thought, well, it didn't feel like a perfect script, but just to have it there, just to have interesting, full, rich characters was huge.
Yeah, I did not see or even hear of the movie. Again, I was in a small southern city. We had a handful of movie theaters that were only going to get the most mainstream movies coming out at that time. So I actually had never even heard of the movie until I was in college. I was home one summer. My parents had finally gotten, like, you know, had recently gotten cable. And I actually saw it while flipping channels. And I had no idea it existed. And I was just blown away by it. And you know, for the reasons that you and Val have said, you know, and additionally, of course, you know, a darker skinned Indian woman and Sarita Chowdhury, she's also mixed as I am. She's half Indian, but she is also very obviously Indian. Because when you look at movies coming out of India, you know, a lot of those characters are very, very light skinned. So I had seen all these, you know, Hindi movies and Telugu movies on videotape that my parents would watch. And so they were even so light skinned. I just couldn't even, like, I would see a movie and sometimes think it had white people in it until like got closer and was like, oh, this is actually a Hindi movie. But they put the whitest Indian right. I've ever seen in my life in there. So absolutely, Sejal, to your point of colorism, to your point of, you know, seeing, it was so complex to show the love between the two communities, but also the anti-Blackness in the Indian community.
I think also for me, because I hadn't been to, my mother was born in Uganda and grew up in Kenya, yes. And I hadn't been there, and to see that, like that loss of, you know, I'd heard these stories, but there was so much that, you know, if you never see part of your history ever represented. In fact, people, the question is like, if you're Indian, why was your mother in Africa? Because people have been moving around for years.
Sure.
You know, why were white people in India? I mean.
And seeing these families in the South, like I've never.
Yes, also the South. I hadn't seen.
Indians yeah. depicted in the South, right? I remember, you know, Baraki Mukherjee, right? Who was a very early influence of me, wrote about Indians in the Midwest, right? That was the first, you know, right. Jasmine, you know, there's an Indian in the Midwest. I was like, wow, like there's, you know, here are Indians being depicted somewhere else besides, you know, New York City or Chicago or Houston or, you know. So it was groundbreaking on so many levels. And I love, Steve, that you asked the question about the kinds of legacies and Val that you brought that up, because it's true. I mean, when you have a kind of touchstone like that, it really opens up your world as a writer and an artist. If you are otherwise, especially if you're otherwise deprived of the communities that you long to be with.
Absolutely. You know, it strikes me that we've talked about inputs, right? We've talked about sort of larger cultural influences. We've talked about a writing community. We've talked about sort of your, you know, those folks who have come before us, those, you know, the folks in our literary lineage. I'd love to move towards sort of outputs, right? How we take all that in and how we make conscious decisions about how we're going to write for sort of specific audiences and then sort of audiences at large. And so, you know, each of the books or the works that you've worked on have really made sort of important contributions with regards to talking about race. And I'm curious, and whoever would like to go to first, like, how did you decide, like, I assume that there was conscious decision about whose cultural perspective you were going to write from, right? And so that's part of the question. And then I think the jumping off point is then, how do you ensure that your work has that sort of cross-cultural lens, that it is speaking to more than one group? Or is that important? Is that not important?
Well, I would say my work is focused on centering the stories of Black women and Black women's lives. So my first book was focused on Zora Neale Hurston. The book that's coming out with Alice Walker, of course, is her journals. So it's her voice, clearly. And I have another book that I'm working on that will be published in the fall. It's called Bigger Than Bravery, Black Resilience and Reclamation in a Time of Pandemic. And for that book, I've asked several writers, several Black writers to write essays and poems about how we've made it through this difficult time. That book has an interesting backstory because I conceived it as Black and Brown writers. And when I ended up finding a publisher, it's being published by Lookout Books at UNC Wilmington. They felt like the book was going to be too big for what they wanted to do, what they could invest. So they asked me to make the difficult decision of narrowing it a bit. And so I, with their input, had to narrow it to Black writers as opposed to Black and Brown writers. And that was a difficult decision for me because I intentionally wanted that cross-cultural dialogue. But as I thought about it, I thought about the particular pains of this period for Black people, given the racial pandemic that we are experiencing alongside the, you know, global health pandemic. And so it made sense to narrow it down that way, but it always made me conscious of the Brown gaze, the Brown reader, the Brown writer, the Brown voices that I wanted to be in conversation with. And not just Brown voices, though that was specifically the way I framed it. It's also people of color, whether they identify as Brown or yellow or what, whatever. And also, of course, for white readers as well. It's a conversation for us all, but it's a conversation that privileges Black voices and Black perspectives. And that felt important to do in a book that was about this particular period of dual pandemics that have affected all of us harshly, but especially Black people. And so for me, it's always a matter of, I speak as a Black woman. That's my voice. That's the only voice I have. However, I speak to everyone. I listen to everyone. I communicate. I speak to communicate. And so even though I speak in my singular Black woman's voice, I'm speaking to and with, perhaps not for anyone other than myself, but I'm speaking to and with a much broader community always.
I love that. I want to pin, we're going to get back and talking about sort of the publishing industry. And so that anecdote is going to be a great jumping off point. But Anjali and Sejal, like, were there conscious decisions that you made, or did you as you wrote your books about your audience and about having sort of a broader appeal, or it was similar to Valerie, it was, look, I'm writing from a perspective, and I'm writing, again, you know, from my own experience, and the themes that I'm talking about are universal. I'm curious.
You know, I would say it's a good question, Steve. And it's interesting to having to go back to think about how something came about like that. You know, the first like 100 drafts of my book, I wrote only thinking of myself and me as the audience. Like I kind of can't think of the bigger picture and the bigger readership when I'm really early in the book. But then after reading it over and over and over again, what I found not only interesting to me as a reader, but I thought other readers could relate to, was sort of the journey of trying to decolonize, of trying to detangle myself from white supremacy, right? Of realizing the ways that I benefited from it, and either stayed silent or not spoken loudly enough, where I've sort of thought of me in a bubble instead of looking more at a community and community building and amplifying and uplifting other people. So that thread ended up being both interesting to me, and I thought, this is probably going to be interesting to other readers for a couple of reasons, but the big one would be is because I'm a brown person talking about it. I think we as a society still demand that white people reckon with their relationship to white supremacy, but we're not really trying to ask brown people to do it, right? That seems almost like, you know, some people feel that that's crossing the line when brown people, and I say that generally because I'm a mixed race person, so I kind of identify as brown almost more than any other identifier. But I think we as brown people have always benefited from white supremacy. Obviously, we have some very vulnerable groups, and we're not a monolith. And we have folks that are really, really hurting, similarly to Latinx folks and Black folks. So I don't want to be too general there. But we have not really been forced to reckon with the ways that we uphold white supremacy in the way that we should. So what I hoped when I got further along with the book was that maybe other brown folks would start seeing some of the ways that they've been complicit when they were reading my book. And that's kind of what I hoped would happen. And what I think might have happened in the people that I've talked to about it, but that ended up also being the most interesting thread to me in the book, was saying the things that are kind of embarrassing and that are shameful in order to then activate and advocate for the dismantling of white supremacy.
I thought I would maybe read a little bit from the interview that the conversation that Valerie and I had, because it's about the importance of editors of color. And Valerie was one of my editors with This Is One Way to Dance. And, you know, I struggled a lot with the beginning of what note did I want to open on with the book. So with Prelude was opening in one way, and then the second essay is called Skin, which is once a short story, and it's got things in there that sound like stereotypes that often, I read it first at a reading that was Asian American writers reading, and then in other spaces that were writers of color. It's not something I ever would have brought into the kind of white workshops I was in back in graduate school. And it's, you know, it starts with, this is what the white boys say. And anyway, I had some moments in there, and I had something about Black boys that I felt a little uncomfortable about given what's been going on in the US. And I felt like maybe I ought to cut it. And it was really helpful to talk to Valerie to have a conversation about it. Like, does this work in this essay? Does this work as an essay? Do I cut this? And I don't know that I could have had that. I don't know what that conversation would have been like with a white editor. I don't know. So this is from Creative Nonfiction. So you can also find this online, this interview that I worked with. So I'm saying I worked with several excellent white editors when I was publishing in literary journals. However, you, Valerie, and Walter Biggins were the first Black editors I'd worked with, and I'd been publishing in national journals since 91. So Valerie wrote to me after one of my essays was published, and I said, you were the first book editor who reached out to me. There's historically been a serious absence of editors of color in publishing. And Valerie said, editors who are people of color, we see things through a different lens. It's been okay for white editors to not know anything about us, to not know anything about what we do, to not understand our writing, to not read our writing, to be dismissive of people of color. They have been the center of the universe. Who cares what this Indian writer in Rochester is writing? Who cares what this Black woman in Atlanta is writing? What does that have to do with me? One time I had a white student at Antioch, where I used to teach, say, before I took a class with you, I had never had to care what a Black woman thought. It had not mattered to me in any real way. And I think that's true for so many white people. And that's why editors of color matter. Often white editors tend to choose white writers because of the long tentacles of white supremacy. I mean, let's face it, even the most well-intentioned white people still think white people are the best. That's what white supremacy teaches us all, regardless of our race. So when they're sitting down to come up with an anthology, they're thinking, okay, who's the best? And they're just naturally thinking of white people. And then they're like, oh, but wait, Zora Neale Hurston was kind of good, right?
That is a great segue to talk, to move into sort of the publishing industry. And I'd love to hear, Anjali and Valerie, from you, like, you know, we talk about publishing and it sounds like this sort of nameless, faceless sort of behemoth, right? But there are a constellation of people who touch the work, right? Including editors, you know, acquisition editors, production editors, et cetera, copy editors. And they have the power to really ensure that our work appeals to wide and diverse audiences, or to push and say, well, it really belongs in a box over here, Valerie, to the anecdote. And I don't mean to say they were saying that it belonged in a box, but to narrowing the focus. And I'm curious what either of you would like to share about your experiences or to reaffirm what Sejal said in an interview about how important that is to have folks who have a common experience or who have those references as they're reviewing and editing your work.
I would just say that thanks for reading that excerpt, Sejal. I feel like you and I were just really relaxed in that conversation, and I was maybe more blunt than I might have been normally, and I'm happy that it came out that way. But I just want to say that my work as an editor at University of Georgia Press, as senior consulting editor for the Bitter Southerner magazine, my long career as an editor, I mean, as editor of Alice Walker's journals, my work as an editor is becoming increasingly important to me because I understand the power that I have as an editor. And when I think about someone as like Toni Morrison as my literary mother, obviously she spent so much time as an influential editor at Random House and was able to publish some of the writers whose work we love and know, Gail Jones, you know, Toni Kate Mabara, Leon Forrest, work that she did as an editor. And so it's really important that there are editors of color, and there are very few who have that kind of power. So that power becomes increasingly important to me. And I just want to point out that Crux, the nonfiction series at UGA Press, published books by all three of you. So I feel pretty smart right now. Like, you know, I mean, this speaks for itself. And I think that speaks to the importance of editors of color who have the ability and the power to say, no, let's look at this writer. Let me just email Sejal, who I only know through social media, because I just read an essay by her that impressed me and I wanted to see what else she might be working on. Or let me just email Anjali because I know she's been working on a bunch of stuff for a while and she's killing it. She's killing the game and all these pieces I see coming out from her. So let's see if there's a collection there. You know, so to be able to have that kind of leverage within a publishing house is huge. And it results in, you know, books by three great writers like you. I can do only so much as a writer with the stories I want to tell. I'm one of those crazy writers who picks stories that take 5 or 6 years to do. I got to work on that. I got to become like every 18 months, churn out a book. You know, as I get older, I'm like, come on, you know, you're running out of time. Let's go get these books out. But what I can do as an editor is I can help you get your book out. I can help get these other voices out. And that is so important to me. That's also what I do as a teacher. I direct a low residency MFA program in narrative nonfiction at the University of Georgia. So there are writers that I'm bringing in, I'm recruiting, we're training, and they're publishing books. And so we're getting all these beautiful Black and Brown voices and other people of color's voices out into the world. And I think that's what editors of color can do.
And I want to start out, first of all, saying, Steve, that Val is probably responsible for like 90% of my career. We met about a dozen years ago when Val was on the board for a small arts website publication. And I had been writing parenting articles for a few years, and I was really tired of it. And Val got me into book criticism, which is still one of my great loves. I love interviewing authors. I love reviewing books. And that's where my career really took off, was because Val was, you know, Val, I don't know if you remember this, but in the conversation we had at a restaurant in Atlanta, you had only read my blog where I blogged about books. And you were like, well, yeah, you've written stuff about books. And I was thinking, it's just a book blog. But she actually put faith in me and brought me in based on a book blog. So anyway, that's one example of many. And what's important here is not just what Val did, but what she did was she, in that one instance with me, what she did in a broader sense was she modeled the behavior that I should have once I started having success. So I've never been an editor. I'm just a writer. But what she did is she modeled the, here you're going up the ladder, gather as many other people who might not have these opportunities and bring them up with you. So that's the attitude, that's the value that I then adopted for myself as a writer, was understanding the power of coalition building and the power of looking to see who's in the room besides yourself, and then making sure that those folks have a leg up on that ladder. And when someone does that for you, you understand how it works and you understand how to give other writers opportunities. And, you know, I'm often, you know, I spend way too much time on Twitter, admittedly, but I will often see, you know, people talk about, where do I pitch this? Where do I pitch that? And, you know, I'll DM them, not just the publication, but the name of the editor and the email address of the editor and how they prefer to receive pitches. And people are like, shocked, right? As if I did something really, really generous, which I don't think I did. I mean, I'm just sharing information that over time one could probably eventually find over Google, but I'm just delivering it to them what I know. But the reason I do that is because I had folks like Val, right? I had other folks who were just like, here, just come through the door now. Like, you don't need to prostrate yourself and beg and plead for 10 more years and pitch 80 million times. Just come through the door with me. And I think that's so important for the Black community and the Brown community to keep doing that work. And we learn how to do it from the best, from the people that were a few steps ahead of us in the game. You know, I released 2 books last year, and I would say probably 90% of the publicity, the informal publicity, right? The people who Instagram or tweet or talk about the book online or invited me, you know, to speak on a panel or interviewed me for the books, like 90% of them were Black and Brown folks. I mean, if I was not in community with Black and Brown folks, my books would have just been published quietly, never to be seen or heard from again, right? I mean, it's these folks that lifted me up, which really hammers in the lesson to me. Bring as many people as you can who the publishing industry, which is still very, very white, is not going to otherwise see or is not going to otherwise acknowledge. And I think that's how we make it in this industry that can be very political, very toxic, very, you know, racist, and of course bigoted in multiple ways, right? But that's how we do it. We bring everyone with us on our journey, and every success that we have as individuals is not really an individual success, right? My books coming out last year was Val's success. It was Walter Biggin's success, who was the acquisitions editor and who acquired my book, who was a Black man. It is the success of the Asian editors who I wrote, you know, political pieces for, and who solicited me, and you know, who solicits me generally for work? It's Black and Brown editors. So it's kind of just the life cycle of community and coalition building within publishing that we Black and Brown folks need to keep going.
I have to say just real briefly, you know, Valerie, the Crux series, again, you all were home to my book, and Sejal, both you and Anjali, I felt that, like, you lifted me up, connecting me to resources, offering me advice, you know, inviting me into conversations such as these. And so I have to say I'm grateful. And in many ways, again, that is, again, like, how do we bring in folks who look like us, who don't look like us, who, you know, have different experiences? How do we, I think the word you used at some point was coalition. And how do we build sort of a broader coalition, again, beyond the Black and white sort of binary? You know, Sejal, you know, I'm struck by this point, like, you know, we talk about sort of the editing process, right? But that's, it's not, it has to be sort of negotiated, right? And in many ways, you have to advocate for yourself in the editing process, no matter who your editor is, to make sure that your voice is authentic and that it's reaching the right audiences. And can you say more about that in terms of, like, your work and shaping it and making sure that it, again, that you have some agency in that, in the publication process?
Yeah, it's hard. I think you have to, it's about trusting yourself to some degree also. But I think one thing I wanted to say, this is such a great conversation, Anjali and Val, what you both said. I was thinking about this. So I'm first gen college on my mom's side, and she's really the person that I talk of my parents that I talk to about things. And I was just thinking about, like, office hours, right? Like, if you don't understand what office hours are really, or, like, you go and you ask for help, but it's also about building a relationship, right? And, you know, the more that I've read about being first gen, I just realized, like, it's also made me think about that in publishing, right? Where there's gatekeeping, there are rules, there are, you know, if you're not already part of the culture, how do you learn it? And then how do you help other people? So, you know, I had an editor reach out to me who was interested in, you know, acquiring manuscripts, and I was able to pass along the names of a couple of friends. And I had this moment of, you know, I'd finished an MFA program a long time ago. Like, how come no one did this for me? And when Val did reach out, I mean, I don't know. I don't want to, I felt like it changed my life. I mean, I had also actually written to another editor at Georgia. So it wasn't, we were already in certain circles, but I was thinking about where are those moments where, you know, you can make a decision to open the door for someone or to lend a hand or to look around, Anjali, as you're saying, and to not get lost in that. I think it can really feel like a zero sum game, right? With, like, there's not enough out there for people. And so maybe feeling like, you know, if you have something, do you want to share it? And that's not, it's kind of an awful way to feel. So I think just about moving it forward and bringing people along. I really appreciate that. Steve, I didn't really answer your question about.
No, it was more a statement, and it's in conversations we've had that, again,
yeah,
it's important to have sort of diverse editors, but also to recognize the agency that we have in, you know, in crafting the narrative. You and I have discussed even in the marketing and the promotion of it.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, how much I really admired, I have to tell you, you know, I mean, you'd reached out to me, but when I saw your, I loved your title. I was like, this is awesome. Hi, Yella, a modern family memoir. I just thought that was actually a wonderful example of code switching and of, I think, Mark, I mean, for me, it worked as marketing and a fabulous photo. I just wanted to, I want to know this. You are so cute.
Yeah, you know, you're right. And again, I think it was, you know, I mean, before landing at UGA, I had other folks who questioned the title and the subtitle. And I'm like, no, I intentionally know who I'm appealing to. And that Modern Family, you know, the High Yella, you know, it's a term that's predominantly used in the Black community. And most folks in the Black community, many of them would recognize it. But that Modern Family memoir also was meant to sort of convey that, you know, as a gay parent, there was a bit of sort of, sort of flagging there that this might be something about something else. It could be about gay parenting. It could be about diverse families. It could be about many different things. But again, there was some negotiating, and certainly not with UGA, you all got it immediately. But in other places, you had to be, you know, I found myself needing to be really intentional and saying, no, this is really what I'm trying to get at here. And so I think that's so important. Well, you know, we've got a few minutes left, and I would love, as we sort of come to the tail end of this great conversation, to go around and ask each of you, are there, as you think about the conversation that we've had today, are there books out there? Are there writers out there that you might recommend for folks who are watching this panel, who want to see great examples of writers who are writing in innovative and creative ways, who are breaking that through that black and white binary? Who are the folks who might be in the sort of literary mothers and fathers and aunts and uncles for other folks out there? So whether these are current writers or past writers. And so Valerie, I'd love to begin with you if you don't mind.
I would say, all three of you, the books that you've written and the ways that you have broken through with your voices. I really appreciate what you were saying, Steve, about advocating for oneself as an author. One thing that I tell my students is you have to have thought everything through. You need to know what your book is and what it isn't. And so if somebody wants to sway you in this whole different direction, perhaps you'll be open to that, but perhaps you won't, because you know, no, I've thought this through and this is what my book is. So in your case, clearly you had thought through the title, you had thought through the subtitle, you knew what you wanted to convey. And it doesn't mean that we're not open to conversation, but it means you have a very clear idea of who you are and what you're writing and who you're writing it for and what you're trying to convey. And I think that's really important. And to have the strength of your own convictions, which can be difficult, especially in an industry that is predominantly white. And there are ways in which, you know, you might be made to feel that your opinion isn't quite valid or you don't quite know what you're doing. That's why it's important to have, you know, editors of color and just writers of color. Steve, you mentioned Sejal and Anjali and the support that they provided as fellow writers. That's so important, to just have a community of people that you can turn to say, let me tell you my experience here. What do you think? Was yours similar? I think that kind of community, that kind of sisterhood and brotherhood and kinship among us as peers is really important. So when I think about peer writers, I think about you all. I think about writers like Kiese Lehman. I think about Sarah Broom. I think about Linnell George, who has a really great book on Octavia Butler that recently came out that really is a beautiful delving into the archive. I think about Disha Filya, who did an amazing book of short stories that was published by Tiny West Virginia University Press. I think about so many colleagues who are out here doing important major work. And I think about being in community with those writers. I appreciate what you said, Anjali, about me just kind of trying to bring as many people through the door with me as I can. That's what I do. I'm not a gatekeeper, I'm a gate crasher. It's like, hey gang, I got the key, let's go, you know? And so that's what we're doing here. And so I think about the ancestral writers who've inspired me, but I also think about my sisters and brothers in community. And you all are a part of that. So I'll just leave it at that.
Oh, and thank you so much for all that you've done for us and so many other writers. Anjali, I'd love to hear from you. Who would you recommend for folks? Who should they be watching and reading?
You know, honestly, there are just so many to recommend, but I think a book that really changed my life as a reader and a writer, and what made a book that made me realize the importance of decolonizing both my reading and my writing was, and I'm gonna mess up the pronunciation of his last name, maybe y'all know it, Matthew Seleses, is that correct? Craft in the Real World. This book is a seminal book for me. It's kind of the book that I've been looking for my whole life that I couldn't seem to find. It really is about how steeped we teach craft, how steeped it is in white supremacy, how our reading is steeped in white supremacy. You can use it as an analogy for art and art consumption and the kind of art that gets elevated. And I think something clicked for me when I read that book personally as a writer was that I think I've spent a lot of my life not writing with as much risk as I wanted to, because I had always had it in my head that it was the white writers that got to do that, right? I mean, you know, you see the books that are allowed to use very sort of non-traditional narratives in storytelling. And I've never felt that Black and Brown writers could get away with it to the degree that white writers are always exalted for. I'm gonna stick the landing with that one book, Steve, just because I feel like I hope everybody who hasn't read it gets a chance to read it, because it really is a groundbreaking book that has reframed my understanding of storytelling. And I will never read another book or do any kind of writing without really sort of thinking about the principles that he writes in the book.
Great recommendation. And Sejal, we've got about a minute left. Love to hear.
Okay, yes. Thank you. I had Craft in the Real World also. I would also say David Moore, this is also Georgia, Stranger's Journey, Race, Identity, and Narrative Craft in Writing. It's also University of Georgia Press. This book was very helpful to me. I think when it came out before Matthew's book, and the anti-racist, writing workshop, How to Decolonize the Creative Classroom, Felisa Rose Chavez, also recommend this. And she mentions June Jordan's Poetry for the People, which is a book that came out in the 90s and feels, I couldn't find my copy today or I'd show that. But going back to June Jordan, I think is always a good idea. And she was teaching at Berkeley, but was also teaching students to go out and teach poetry in the community. And so it was kind of the opposite of the MFA world that I went in. I keep going back to that. So I would say her as a ancestor and these other books for now that are current.
Well, Sejal Shah, Anjali Enjeti, Valerie Boyd, thank you so much for an incredible conversation. Those great recommendations. And I invite everyone who, again, who's watching this panel to go onto the website, again, read their bios, make sure you write down the works, their books, their titles. Those are great reads. Those would be my recommendations. And our thanks, of course, to Writers and Books and the underwriter of this panel, the Disability Visibility Project. My name is Steve Majors. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great afternoon.